Good morning. On this beautiful morning, we read the Gospel from Matthew today, where Jesus comes into the crowd, and a man came up to him, kneeling before him, and saying, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and he suffers terribly. For often he falls into the fire and often into the water. And I brought him to your disciples and they could not heal him." And Jesus answered, "O faithless and perverse generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me here." And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured instantly. And then the disciples came to Jesus privately, and they said, "Why could we not cast this spirit out?" And the Lord said, "Because of your little faith. For truly I say to you, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible to you. But this kind, this spirit, this demonic force cannot come out except by prayer and fasting." So we have here two elements. One is the issue of faith. And I think that we live in a world today which suffers from lack of faith. Why am I saying this? Well, personal experience. We live in a world which is very logical in everything that we do. We live in a world where everything has to be in a certain way. We live in a world where everything has to be analyzed in a rationalistic way. We live in a world where everything has to be explained in a scientific way. And faith is what comes beyond logic. Faith is what happens when you jump the barrier of logic and rationalism. And I think the disciples were suffering from that even at that time. And the disciples were people who were next to Christ. They saw him do other miracles. That's why he sent them out. He said, "Go and cast spirits out," and they come here and they can't do it. Why? Because somewhere the rational influence in them has prevented them from being able to function with faith. That's the first thing. The second is that some of these spirits, they're very powerful, and they require prayer and fasting. And that's why the church has set fasting throughout the year. We have fasting on Wednesdays and Fridays throughout the year to honor Christ. We have fasting during the 15 days before the Feast of the Theotokos, we celebrated yesterday, the Dormition, so that we may prepare, so that we may cast out the demons in our own lives, in our own minds, in our own hearts. And we have prayer every day. Somebody said to me, who didn't know what we do usually, was asking me, and said, "You know, I came by the church every other afternoon. There were cars there. Do you have services every night?" Well, these 15 days of August, yes, we did. We had the paraclesis, the supplication to the Theotokos every evening, because the prayer and the fasting go together. As we prepare to cast down every influence of the devil, as we prepare to cast down every sin from our hearts and every negative thought from our own minds. So, I know that we have negative thoughts. I know we have thoughts of doubt. I know we have, these are all human condition. This is part of the human condition. These are all human faults. But they're part of who we are. And the way to cast them out is through prayer and fasting, which also leads to faith, and the power of God, which casts out demons. So, such a person we celebrate today, and that was St. Joseph the Hesychast. St. Joseph the Hesychast, as a young man, his name was actually Francis. Very interesting. He was from Paros, an island of Greece, which was probably under the Italians for such a long time that the Italian influence of naming and things like that happened. So he comes out of Paros in the 30s, maybe. And he decides, after his fiancée died, he decides to become a monk. So he goes to Mount Athos. But he wants, if he's going to spend the rest of his life on Mount Athos, he wants to do the most important, whatever he needs to do, ascesis, ascetic life, so that he can acquire the Holy Spirit, as he learned from the books that he was reading, and as he heard about some of the monastics that they had, and Christians in general. He wanted the power of the Holy Spirit in him. He wanted to be cleansed, purified, and receive the Holy Spirit. So he went from cell to cell, from cave to cave, trying to meet elders that would teach him how to pray, how to live an ascetic life. And in the end, he retreated, put himself under an altar in the area of New Skid on Mount Athos, and there he spent the rest of his life. He was declared a saint. He died in 1959. He died in 1959 on the day of the Dormition of the Theotokos. And he knew that was the day that he was going to die. One of his disciples, very young at the time, was Elder Ephraim of Arizona, who also died last year. He told me the story himself. He says, he took me, he called me into his cell, and he says to me, I'm going to die on the 15th of August, on the day of the Theotokos. And I want you to come and bring me tea and sit next to me. After the celebration of the liturgy, Elder Ephraim, he went, young Ephraim at the time, he went and sat down next to him, brought him tea, and as he was talking to him, he expired. Okay? He didn't lie down. He died in his chair that he was sitting in as he was talking to young Ephraim. Now, this elder, Joseph, was declared a saint recently. Was it January? November, last November? It was recent. He's the most recent of the saints that the Patriarchate of Constantinople declared. And he had this power that God gave him through prayer and fasting. He was a strict faster and prayed unceasingly. He was a master of the Jesus prayer. He learned how to completely immerse himself in prayer for days. And the people who came around him received from him this gift as well. And I met all of them. One of them is Elder Ephraim from Arizona, and the other was Elder Haralambos, that I met on Mount Athos in 1986. And I spent a few days with him. And he had me learn the Jesus prayer, how to do the Jesus prayer. He had me in the cell by myself for hours praying. So I received that gift. So this elder Joseph is like a grandfather to me, since I received from one of his children, from two of his children actually, blessings and instruction through the years, the last 40 some years of my life. And an elder Ephraim left Mount Athos and came to the United States and Canada, and he established monasteries. He established 18 monasteries between Canada and the United States. When he was also on Mount Athos, he was the abbot of the monastery of Philotheus. And so he has, in fact, left behind a great number of disciples, monks, on Mount Athos, that now man like three different monasteries on Mount Athos. So, Elder Joseph gave his life to God and gave his life to prayer and fasting. And as a consequence, somebody like Father Ephraim came out of him, who produced a great number of disciples and touched the hearts and the minds of a great number of others, like me, priests, lay people, who met him. And then Elder Haralambos came out of that group as well, who was the abbot of the monastery of Dionysiou, who again touched the lives of many people, including again me. And I'm so blessed. And then there was Elder Joseph, the new Joseph of Vadobedi, whom I also met, who died at Vadobedi, who created this brotherhood of monks who took over the great lavra of Vadobedi, which was basically in disarray and disrepair. And now there are 140 monks. It's the most lively monastery of Mount Athos, and it's the most wonderful place to go for liturgy on a Sunday morning. I brought actually an unorthodox person to Mount Athos one time. Strat and I took him. We went, all three of us, and we ended up at Vadobedi and spent the last 2 days before we left. And this Protestant man, at the end of the service, he spent most of the time in the exonarthics because they won't let them go into the church. And at the end of the service, he says, "This was the most amazing experience," he says to me, "of worship. I was at the altar, I just immersed myself in that." He was outside, basically. But the chanting, the prayers, the atmosphere, the faith that resonates on every wall of that monastery and comes out to touch hearts, that touched even a Protestant professor, intellectual, rationalist, in every possible way. And so we see that a man who decides to immerse himself in prayer and fasting and surrender in faith to God, he may not move mountains like the Lord says in this. He may not do miracles that will be apparent to people, but he can change the world. Joseph the Hesychast is single-handedly considered to be one of the people who revived Mount Athos in the 70s and 80s and 90s. Okay? And all he did was to basically live alone in a cave first, in a second cave, and finally in a little house that I visited and where his tomb is. Right by the sea, the most beautiful setting, dedicating his life to God in a very special way. So, what is the lesson for us? I would say, how does it affect us? Do we need to go to Mount Athos? Everybody go to monasteries? Well, not really, not really. God is everywhere. I think that was good for Francis, who became Joseph. That was good for him. He needed that. He needed that seclusion. The rest of us will get the grace of God in the seclusion of our own lives through the shutdown of the coronavirus, for example, if we do it properly. We have a lot more time now than we ever did before. We have slowed down in so many ways from the activities. And I talk to people all the time and they are thankful for that, because we live a crazy life of run, 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 and never stop. It's time to slow down and think about the future, the eternity future, and think about how are we going to relate to our Creator. And this is the time to do it. And God is giving us this opportunity because coronavirus is not going away and we need to be contained for months to come. And God knows what else. So, this is the time to become ascetics, like Joseph, by slowing down the pace of life and spending more time reflecting about who we are, what we're doing, where are we going, where are we heading for, how are we going to do that, and immerse ourselves in prayer and fasting, asking for our lives to be rid of demonic influences and for our lives to be blessed with the Holy Spirit. And this is the time to do it.